everybody. Come on. If God's been faithful, then sing along with us. Everybody say faithful.
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 Faithful
is our God.
Good morning, indeed, and welcome to the Faith That Moves the Mountain radio broadcast. The mission of this program is to teach the precept of faith so as to engender trust in the miraculous power of God and to let all know that with God all things are possible and that the first duty of man is to serve the Lord. I am indeed Deacon Travis Bowe, and the speaker for this program is none other than our very own Bishop, Dr. Perry Edison Newton Sr. And I would also like to take this opportunity to invite you to the Word of Faith Tabernacle, Word of Faith Church, a church where Christ is above all, the center of all, and the foundation of every action. You can join us on Sunday mornings at 11 a.m. for our divine worship service, or even at 10 a.m. for our Sunday school. And then you can join us on Mondays at 7 p.m. for our prayer meeting, or on Wednesdays at 7 p.m. for our Bible study. In fact, don't join us. I will be there personally to meet you at the door. So don't beat me there. Beat me there. And now, tell a friend, text a friend, let a neighbor know that the Faith That Moves the Mountain radio broadcast is on the air. Coming with our opening prayer and to bring to you the word for this morning, our very own man of God, Bishop Dr. Perry Edison Newton Sr.
Let us pray. Eternal Father and our God, I come before your presence this morning to give you thanks. I come to give you praise, and I come to give you all the glory. Realizing this morning that you are God and beside you, there are none other. I pray for our nation. Lord, we pray for our national leaders, pray for our Governor General, Prime Minister, Leader of the Opposition, and all those whom you have set in authority over our land. I pray now for those that are sick, those that are afflicted, those recovering at home. I pray, Lord, that you would bless now this radio broadcast, that some soul will be edified. You, God, glorified, and the devil and his angels horrified. In Jesus' mighty name I pray. Amen.
Love. Yes, come to the Little Professor Christian Academy, where we accept students 4 months to 5 years. Our motto, shaping the next generation of leaders. Phone 3-2-5-2-4-6-6. 3-2-5-2-4-6-6.
This is an invitation from me to you to attend our Sunday morning divine worship service commencing at 11 a.m. At this service, I preach my word of faith sermons. Come out and be blessed as you hear the dynamic word from God, which tells us that God is a God who honors those who seek Him through faith. And without faith, it is impossible to please God. Come down to the Word of Faith Tabernacle each Sunday morning at 11 a.m. to a divine worship service.
God took Adam the woman and brought her to man. Adam said, "This is now bone of my bones and flesh of my flesh."
She yes, the Word of Faith Tabernacle. Located on Coxway off East Street South. Off East Street South. The Word of Faith Tabernacle. Phone 325-2466. Our scripture lesson this morning comes to us from 2 Chronicles, chapter 29. I read from verse 1. Hezekiah began to reign when he was 25 years old. And he reigned 29 years in Jerusalem. And his mother's name was Abijah, the daughter of Zechariah. And he did that which was right in the sight of the Lord, according to all that David, his father, had done. The word of the Lord is blessed. My friends, this morning, I want to speak as the Spirit of the living God gives me utterance. I would like to believe that this message this morning has social connotations with political overtones and with constitutional ramifications. And so I began by saying, if we start off on the wrong foot, chances are we're going to end up on the wrong foot. Over the past week or two, our country was bedeviled by allegations after allegations of alleged political misconduct, which resulted in the resignation of one of what we thought our most promising young Bahamian. The country is saddened by the level of hypocrisy that is being demonstrated by many of our national leaders. The things that have come into public domain leaves us wondering, where is God in the midst of all of this? That politicians find themselves in the house of God each and every day, creating a Christian persona, but then seemingly, as alleged, their disposition in private is one that leaves little to admire. I hear the God of the universe saying that we must all make our calling an election sure, that we must not put our trust in men. But we must put our trust in the King of Kings and Lord of Lords. I wish to remind political leaders this morning of their God-given responsibility to lead a nation not into debauchery, not into malfeasance, not into fleshly inclination, or make it possible for these things to be accentuated. Instead, a government should pontificate in seriousness the good things that will cause young people to want to follow after righteousness. I can recall that not many years ago, it was a good thing to be to come from a hard, struggling family. It was a good thing to come from the island with nothing, no clothes on your backs, with even no shoes on your feet, because you aspired to greatness and you believed that by hard work you could make it. Politicians of that day seemed to have gotten the true idea of what it was to be parliamentarians, how they would encourage Bahamians, young Bahamians, to strive for excellence and to work hard. But today it would seem as though we only have word from politicians, word of the grandeur, word of hard work pays off, when we hear all kinds of bad things being said concerning them, of how they are involved in such, my God, unholy ways, in such ungodly things, and leaves us all with our mouths wide open. It's a shame. It's a shame. And God is not pleased. And for this cause, God is going to raise up a new leader for this country. God is going to raise up a leader which will be after his own heart. And God is going to pull down the mighty from their seats.
Let us repeat.
And God is going to exalt them of low degree. God is going to fill the hungry with good things. And God is going to send the rich empty away. There's going to be an unusual happenings in this country over the next couple of months.
Okay, put your hands
maybe
together.
The next 18 months, something unusual is going to happen in this country. It's going to be so unusual that it's going to go against the grain of what we always thought to be correct. God is going to move in such a mighty way that the knowns will become unknown, and God is going to take some unknown and God is going to catapult them into the leadership of this country. God is going to raise up a man who is going to call for holy principle, who is going to denounce and deny all of this cultural ungodliness that has been sweeping this nation in recent times. My friends, some things that have been written cannot be unwritten. Some things that have been done cannot be undone. And maybe on hindsight, it is best to leave it the way it is. But God is going to raise up a man to lead this nation who is going to have the nation in his heart. Not only will he have the nation in his heart, but he is going to have God in his heart. Some will say he's green. Some may say they do not know what they're doing. But it will be God who is doing the work. And as long as God's man keeps his hand in God's hand, God will guide him in the way that he ought to go. I want to say today that in 2002, the government of that day brought forth some very powerful amendments to the Constitution, which dealt with women's equality and work, etc., etc. The opposition of that day said that they voted for it in the House and it is history. But upon leaving the House, along with a noted attorney, they shifted their course and say that it was not a good thing, that the referendums that were being put forth, the questions, were not to be voted for. Alas, 14 years later, we have been brought to bear with the same, or if not the same, many of the same questions and similar questions. The opposition then is now the government now, is bringing these questions to the Bahamian people. But I hear God of the universe saying that this is a patriarchal society. This is a society where the Bahamian man and the Bahamian patrimony must not be watered down by allowing men from foreign places to come and become equally a Bahamian as the women who will get their name from the Bahamian man. And I stand as a voice against all four of the questions, four of the questions that were put on this present, constitutional reform agenda. And I believe that the PLP 2002 was right then, that it was wrong. I believe that they are wrong now to put those questions. And I think that the opposition today should not have voted in favor of what the government had presented. They will fail to represent the opposition, the people opposite to what the government's views are. And for this reason, they're going to lose some very strong support because they have not represented the dissenting voice to what is going on. Her Majesty's opposition should always stand as Her Majesty's loyal opposition, ready to assume the reins of power, coming with critical criticisms and alternatives to the government proposal, and must have a better idea than what the government is proposing. Unless we were in war, the opposition should never have voted in favor of those government proposed constitutional amendments. And so, since the opposition is weak, God has raised me up to be the opposition and to say to the women and the men of this country who believe that God has given us a patrimony, and that under no circumstances that we, the women of our country, has ever been unequal. The women of our country has always been equal. They always shared equally in the goods of this land. They always were able to get good jobs. They were never not exempted from having good education. They were never exempted from holding the highest office in our land, as is indicative and as the present case today. They have never been exempted from coming to the bars of a Majesty's legislature, nor has a Majesty's judiciary. They have not been exempted from a Majesty's executive. They have straddled all of the fence, and I dare to say, they are head and shoulders above their male counterparts in almost every sphere of our national life. And so it is unfair and indeed disingenuous for politicians and people who want to pontificate and to make some headway for their own personal agenda to subject our constitution to such far-reaching change when there is no immediate and no groundswell for such a constitutional amendment. I wish our governments and now and future governments will listen to what the people want to change. What people want to change in this country is that we have too much undocumented illegal persons in our land. We have too many young Bahamians who were born here, do not know anything about foreign lands, who are without a citizenship. We need to revisit by our constitutional amendment to give young Bahamian, young persons born in this Bahamas, once they are born here, and we can prove that the mother had not been impregnated prior to coming to the Bahamas, but that she was impregnated on Bahamian soil, and that child is born here, we should give them by right the right to be a Bahamian upon their birth, and at 18 they can decide to be something other than a Bahamian if they so choose. We have too many young Bahamians, young persons born here, who have no legitimacy, no constitutional citizenship, and we need This is something that Bahamians are crying to have addressed. We are saddled with the high court called the Privy Council. The Privy Council has said things that run contradictory to what we know that is right and which is biblically sound. That once you are proved to have killed a person, murder, which is premeditated murder, there's no degree in premeditation. There's degree in murder, but the degree is whether it's manslaughter, whether it's an accidental. When it is proved that it was not manslaughter or accident, and it was can be proved beyond a shadow of a doubt that it's premeditated, that is the worst of the worst crime. And if the Privy Council does not serve our end, many Bahamians would like to have the question put. Do you want the Privy Council to remain our High Court of Appeal, or should we have our own appeal court as our High Court of Appeal? These are questions, my friends, which ought to be considered, as opposed to the ones that are now being pontificated and pushed down Bahamian throats. If this was not being pushed down Bahamian's throat, we not would have had to sell it so hard. We would not have to spend the amount of money that we are spending upon it. My friends, let me say, I perhaps will be the last to say that is the best thing that ever happened to the Bahamas. It may be the best thing that happened to the government, because the government is benefiting from it. But the average Bahamian couldn't tell how what and by what means that, how it is being dealt with. Bahamians need to know more about things that more concerns them, as opposed to some vague, personal, deep-seated agenda that is being perpetrated by persons outside of our country. My friends today, but I hear the God of the universe saying that we must all pave our Jericho roads. And people in private government and those who are in the halls of parliament, I hear God saying that we must live a life that will not cause his people to falter and fail. But how can we come to the parliament and tell the young man on the street to stop pushing drugs and stop peddling and stop being corrupt, when it is alleged that many of our politicians, some to the highest office, and not the word alleged, at the highest order, have been called in what we call some despicable allegations. My friends, let me tell you, many of us as Christians, as pastors, we've had our names pulled through the dirt as well. But you know, truth pressed to the ground will rise again. For no lie can live forever. Joel Russell Lowell said, truth forever on the scaffold, wrong forever on the throne, but the scaffold sways the future. And behind the dim unknown standeth God within the shadow, keeping watch above his own. We will overcome because Carlyle is right, that the arc of the moral universe is long, but is bent towards justice. I've came by you this morning to warn politicians that God is getting fed up with the kind of response that he is getting from them towards his people. That they have been pushing the people further and further away from him, leading them into debauchery, leading them into sinful things, spearheading things that brings no glory to God, and anything that has to do with God, they give it lip service. Upon an issue, I don't know how much help the Holy Land proposal has been given in South Andros. But I think that's a wonderful thing that has been done in South Andros. I believe the government can, if they want to do something positive, they can get on and really sponsor in part on the completion of the Holy Land in South Andros that is being spearheaded by Reverend Duncombe and his family or whoever. My friends, this morning, I hear the God of the universe say that he will judge this nation. He will bring judgment to this nation. And he will pull down the mighty from their seats. And he will exalt those of low degree. My friend, today, I don't want us to be hoodwinked. I don't want our Bahamas to believe that they need to follow everything that is happening in the world. Because it has to be a nation
who is God is the Lord, who is going to stand up for Jesus and tell the nations around the world. We were the Vision Village before, and we will stand up for God because God have a way of bringing us through all of our difficulties. It is time for our national leaders to stop playing lip service and to begin to get serious about governing this nation. Stop playing petty politics with one another, pulling down each other, but get on with the business of leading our nation to paths of righteousness. Yes, the preacher can preach, but what if we preach and you are, every time when we try to preach, you open up the door for some other sinful practice to come to this nation. Many people are afraid to speak out. Or many pastors, many leaders have already sold out to the government. But guess what? The government cannot rule the church. The church has the king, and the king of the church is Jesus Christ, the master son of the living God. The government can set agendas for the smooth running of the nation and to keep the nation away from unsavory things. But it is the church that must stand and not agree with everything that the government says because of whatever reason. I stand by my word today that there's no need for the amendments to the Constitution to be made. Because if there was a need, people would have been all around picketing, asking for this to happen. But there is some ulterior motives. I believe that there are some ulterior motives, but time will tell. I don't think we should impose my generation, should impose upon a next generation what we are trying to impose on them. Leave that for the next generation of leaders. Leave that for the next 20 years, when the next or the next 10 years, when we have the Rollins, the Wells, and the upcoming young politicians, let them chart that court. I don't think the leaders and the generations of Lyndon Pinlin should make this call. My friends, these are my views, and I speak as a servant of the living God. Hallelujah. My time is gone. My time is gone.